Welcome to Young Tuition. Let's continue discussing basic issues in atmospheric physics in relation to weather and climate. Nowadays, everyone has been repeatedly told that CO2 in the atmosphere absorbs and emits infrared ray, in particular, centered at 15 micron or 667 wave number per centimeter. Nevertheless, any observational evidence, can you tell? If so, how was the measurement made and by whom? This is a long story, but today I'm going to tell you this untold story one by one. Are you ready? I mean, subscribe, like, share, and write a comment. Okay, let's go and have fun. I assume you know Max Planck, but who is Rubens, you might ask? I can tell you, he's one of the physicists in this old photograph. Can you see Einstein here, Madame Curie, Rutherford, Max Planck here, and here it is, Heinrich Rubens. If you are careful, you could see the Planck's law written on the wall or window between them. Rubens is known for his measurement of the black body radiation, which led Planck to discover his radiation law. He is also known for his first observation of infrared absorption by water vapor and CO2, as shown in this diagram. To help you to see the spectra easily, I have colored the two components, namely the water vapor and the CO2. The importance of this finding is apparent in relation to climate research. As you might have known, Arrhenius had proposed his first CO2-based climate model 2 years earlier without any concrete idea about the proportion of CO2 infrared absorption from the surface. It is important to compare CO2 absorption with water vapor absorption against the black body radiation curve for the given surface temperature, because it will tell us the relative proportions of the two gaseous components if the surface did emit infrared ray similar to a black body. I had estimated the maximum proportion of CO2 absorption before, which is close to 5% in the presence of water vapor. Do you remember? Let's do it again. This is digitally constructed two components in the original diagram published by Rubens and Ashikness. I will refine these spectra in the future, especially the lowest water absorption area. Then the two components were scaled by the Planck function because we are talking about the source as a black body. The region in and around the minimum water vapor absorption is called the atmospheric window, which allows black body source transmit its infrared ray almost freely. Notice, CO2 can only absorb about half of the black body radiation around its absorption center, 667 wave number per centimeter. Just as 10 apples for two twins to pick up, each could get 5 at the most. This has nothing to do with the so-called saturation. Now it's high time for us to introduce the second person in this talk, the late Dr. Rudolf Hanel. He was the chief scientist at NASA, responsible for a number of important space programs, including Venus, the Earth, of course, Mars, and so on, including the Nimbus mission around 1970. I will talk about his relevant work in depth. But this talk is focused on an infrared spectra of the atmosphere measured by Dr. Hanel on the ground in 1969, before Nimbus 3 was launched. Here is a spectra published. The vertical axis is the absorbance of the atmosphere, and the horizontal axis is the wave number per centimeter. First, you will notice that the range of the spectra was confined to 750 to 1,250 wave number per centimeter, or 8 to 13 micron in wavelength. But he didn't explain why. Ideally, one would measure the entire range of infrared rays. The explanation is rather simple. If we superimposed the observed spectra by Dr. Hanel against the blackbody radiation curve with water vapor absorption observed by Rubens and Arrhenius. Let's do it. Here, the black curve is the blackbody radiation at 255 Kelvin, and the blue curve represents the water vapor absorption. It is clear the observational range is the same as the atmospherical window. And the reason why Dr. Hanel couldn't observe infrared spectra beyond this window is due to water vapor absorption. By the way, it is necessary to point out that an infrared source in his observation was either the Venus or the moon outside the atmosphere. In fact, one had used the sun as a source too. For this reason, obviously, the observed infrared spectra of water vapor and CO2 by Rubens in lab can be used as references. How to interpret the observed infrared spectra? According to Dr. Hanel, most nine are due to water vapor except the region between 1,000 and 1,070 per centimeter where ozone bands appear. That's right, at least possible. Having said that, listeners, he went on telling his readers. In addition, the nine of R43 and R61 of the mu 1 minus mu 2 CO2 band, this is one of the combination band, and the nine P18 to P36 of the mu 3 minus mu 1 CO2 band are clearly resolved between 754 to 768 per centimeter. Look, this vertical line. Here is 754, and here is 768. And between 928 to 946 per centimeter, respectively. Look, here is 928, and here is 946. Finally, he wrote, the strong CO2 Q branch near 781 per centimeter is almost distinct from the adjacent water vapor lines. His claim had made me think for a long time. Then I found that the two CO2 combination bands should be located at 1,674 per centimeter and 590 per centimeter, respectively. Let me know if I'm wrong. Given the three basic frequencies are 1,257, 667, 2,343, respectively. As you can see, in general, water vapor can absorb infrared ray at almost all wave numbers, although the absorption is relatively weak between 8 to 13 micron in wavelength. In other words, the so-called atmospherical window is not completely transparent. In passing, the CO2 transitions between 750 and 1,150 per centimeter can only be observed at a high temperature. As you can see, this example, the temperature is 800 K. Besides, the CO2 Q branch near 781 per centimeter should be near 791 per centimeter, and its transition probability is several orders of magnitude weaker than that of the central Q branch, as I discussed before. Based on my investigation, Dr. Hanel was an electronical engineer, not well trained in infrared spectroscopy. It could be argued that his interpretation were told by the other members in his team, rather than from his original research. Above all, it would appear Dr. Hanel didn't carefully consider CO2 and water vapor peaks around 15 microns reported by Rubens and Arrhenius. If he had carefully studied the CO2 absorption spectra published by Rubens and Arrhenius, he wouldn't have overlooked the water vapor signal overlapped with the CO2 absorption band. In short, Dr. Hanel's interpretation of his observed infrared spectra in the atmospheric window is incorrect. Why did he and his team members do so? This is a billion-dollar question. Because it seems they wished to see a CO2 absorption band centered at 15 microns in order to illustrate the greenhouse effect. I will discuss more implications and repercussions next time. Please stay tuned. Thank you for watching, making comments, and a donation. See you next time.